Hey guys, I want to go over the book of Joshua. Joshua chapter number 24, all right? Genesis, Exodus, Leviticus, Numbers, Deuteronomy, Joshua. All right? The sixth book in the Bible. And of course, the book of Joshua is a book where it's a book about conquest. It's a book about victory. It shows how God has taken the people of God out of Egypt. And of course, that happened in Exodus. And then you have Leviticus, which is the handbook for holiness to the priest. Then you have Numbers, sort of a history of their wilderness wandering, and Deuteronomy, sort of a recapitulation where Moses sort of stands with his back to the promised land and his face to this 2 or 3 million people and says to them, remember, 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 remember. You're about to go in and inherit a land that is God's land. It's yours as a possession, not as an ownership. And God is the owner of the land. And just like God gave you the land, God will take it from you. Right? God will remove you from it, or God will send, instead of blessing, he'll send blight, depending upon your obedience to him. He had told them this over in the book of Deuteronomy, chapters 29, 30, 31. Great emphasis of those chapters is if you do this, you'll have blessings. If you do that, you'll have cursing. So there's a choice that's in the air for them. Joshua comes along after Moses' death. And Moses is gone. Now Joshua, who was his lieutenant, now is the leader. And Joshua takes the children of Israel over into the promised land. See, I was pointing out on Tuesday that Moses is a picture of Christ, in that he was the deliverer out of sin's bondage. Egypt pictures sin's bondage. Pharaoh is a picture of the devil, and Egypt is a picture of sin in the world, and there the children of God are there in bondage. And then God, through the shedding of blood, brought them out. Moses is a picture of Christ, just like the Passover lamb. So many pictures of Christ in and out. Aaron is a picture of Christ as the high priest. So many pictures of Christ in the book of Exodus. All the sacrifices pictured Christ. But Moses brought them out. But Moses wouldn't take them in. Moses dies and Joshua takes them in. And Joshua is a picture of Christ. Not just a deliverer from Egypt, but he delivered them into their blessing. God brought them out so he could bring them in. So God didn't just want them wandering around in the wilderness. He wanted them to go in and possess their possession. Go in and enjoy the blessings. Go in and enjoy the pomegranates and the strawberries and the olives and all of this. The sweet waters. To live in houses that they didn't build. And to drink from wells that they didn't dig. Right? To enjoy bounty. And that's what God wants for us as believers, right? We've come out of Egypt, not to just meander around in the wilderness, but rather to go into our possessions, to go into all that is ours. That's why Joshua pictures Jesus in this sense. Jesus brings us out, but Jesus is the one who takes us into all of our blessing. You're not going to find your blessing as a believer apart from Christ. Don't get the idea that now I got it from here, God. No, no, no. You need Christ to take you in to the fullness of your blessing. And we're not talking about strawberries and olives and pomegranates. We're talking about love and joy and peace and long-suffering and goodness. All these things that are fruit of the what? Spirit. The spiritual riches. Not things that money can buy, but things that money cannot buy. Real riches. Joshua now is an old man of about 110 years old, because they have fought the battles. By the way, I tell you that the blessings and the battles are always in the same place. There were blessings in the Canaan, but there were battles in Canaan as well. The blessings and the battles are in the same place. So God said to them, basically, this land is your land. I've given it to you. Now fight for it. It's no different than the spiritual reality of that thing. God says, joy is yours. Now, are you going to have it or not? Peace is yours. Are you going to have it or not? All these things he's given us by the Holy Spirit who lives in us, there's some battles to have it. You're not going to just accidentally inherit them, though they are all yours, though they are all mine. The question is, will you have them? Will you have them? Christ leads us into that. Joshua now is 110 years old. He, like Moses, has his face to these people. Moses had his face to these people before they went in. Now that they are in, Joshua has his face to these people, and Joshua is about to move off of the scene. And Joshua gives in Joshua 24 his valedictorian address, his sort of a farewell address to the nation. He calls them all to a place called Shechem. And right there in central part of the nation. All right? Dan and Beersheba, Shechem. Shechem is this place, central place. And he called for all the people. Not every man, woman, boy, girl, but the leaders of the tribes and of the families and the clans. And they brought them there, all the representative leaders. He calls for them, and he basically gives them this valedictorian address. And I want to jump down here into verse number 13. And I want to read down to verse number 15, which, by the way, 15, the last part of verse number 15 is the most famous part of the book of Joshua. But he says this, I have given you a land which you did not labor, for which you did not labor, and cities which you built not, and ye dwell in them, of the vineyard and olive yards which ye planted not, do ye eat. In other words, this land is your land. I've given it to you. It was me who gave it to you. All this stuff you inherited, I'm the one who blessed you with it. Don't forget that. It's always good for us to keep our memory green where the blessings come from. Lest you become proud and conceited, remember where the blessings come from. Were it not for the goodness of God, were it not for the open, benevolent hand of God. So he says, I've given these things to you. You could not have them without me. I'm the one who's given them to you. Listen to what he says. Now, therefore, verse 14, fear the Lord. Now, the Bible talks about the fear of the Lord. By the fear of the Lord, men depart from evil, from iniquity. The fear of the Lord being the beginning of knowledge. The fear of the Lord being the beginning of wisdom. The fear of the Lord. Fear of the Lord. The fear of the Lord. The idea of a reverence for God, a respect for God, a carefulness before God. That I need to have, that you need to have, that's to fear the Lord, a reverence for the Lord. Not to be afraid of the Lord. I've said this before, not to be afraid of the Lord, but to hear and to heed him. There's a certain carefulness. Stan, you know what I'm talking about. Your daddy is there. When your dad says something, your ears perk up. It's not like your brother's talking to you. You may or may not listen. When my dad called me from another room, it wasn't the way I responded when my brothers called me. Those jokers called me. I said, what? Can't you see I'm watching Mighty Mouse? Right? What? When daddy called me, it was, sir, as I moved towards him. Not because I was afraid of him, but my dad's voice was different. And I was a little afraid of him. Can't discount that. Well, you know, because dad had that authority, and that's reverence. That's right. The one who possesses our very lives. The one who possesses the lives of the people we love most. I mean, God is not to be toyed with. So he says, hey, now therefore fear the Lord and serve him in sincerity and in truth, and put away the gods which your father served on the other side of the flood. That's the river, the Euphrates River. He said, your father served foreign gods on the other side of the Euphrates River. And even in Egypt, he says, put away those things and serve ye the Lord. Now, let me catch you up. What he's saying here, he's talking to this nation. God has brought them in to their possession. And he's saying to them, hey, listen, fear the Lord. He's the one who's given you this place. Fear him. Live for him. He says, let's be honest now. You can't serve the Lord and your other gods. These little trinkets and idols that you have that your forefathers served back over on the other side of the Euphrates. Now, who were they? Well, I'll tell you who they were. Abraham, who's the father of the nation. Abraham, his dad, and his dad before him. They were all on this, the other side of Euphrates, and they lived in Ur, and they were moon worshipers. They were moon worshipers. So when God struck up a friendship with Abraham, he called him out of that. And Abraham had to believe Yahweh and begin to walk with Yahweh because God befriended him, struck up a friendship with him. Abraham believed God, and God imputed it for righteousness. But I want you to understand that he came from a pagan place. You said, you mean Father Abraham? Yep. It was the goodness and grace of God. If you don't believe that, just read back over in chapter number 24, verses 1 and 2. In fact, notice what he says here in verse number 1. And Joshua gathered all the tribes of Israel to Shechem and called for the elders of Israel and for their heads and for their judges and for their officers. And they presented themselves before God. See, that's the representative leadership there. And Joshua said unto all the people, thus saith the Lord God of Israel, your fathers dwelt on the other side of the river, on the other side of the flood in old time. Even Terah, the father of Abraham, and the father of Nahor, and they served other gods. See that? This is what God called them from. And so now God is saying here, you're in your land. I've brought you out. I've brought you in. He says, now you fear the Lord. Serve him in sincerity and in truth. Put away the gods your father served on the other side of the river and in Egypt. Now, they served other gods in Egypt. And I'm going to just tell you right now. It's so easy. We get right there in the crowd and we do what? We in Rome? What? Do what the Romans do. You in Egypt? Do what the Egyptians do. I'm just telling you right there, while they were slaves in Egypt, about 400 years, there were Jewish people who began to dabble with the gods of Egypt. Now, you remember how God came and rescued them, and God absolutely brought Egypt down and showed their gods to be nothing. And Yahweh showed himself to be strong God, and he brought them out. But I want you to see that there are people who begin to sort of just blend in with the crowd around them. So, yes, they came from idolatry back here. They were living in idolatry, really, in Egypt. God says, I brought you out, and I've shown you with my strong arm who I am. I brought down a nation before you. I fed you in the wilderness. I gave you drink, had a rock that followed you, and I gave you food from heaven, and I showed myself strong on your behalf. I brought down formidable walls. I split swollen rivers. I've chased nations out with hornets and wasps. and I've brought you and delivered you here. He says, you put away the gods your father served. You put away the gods they served over in Egypt. He said, and serve Yahweh. Here's what Joshua says. Here's this famous verse now. He says, and if it seem evil unto you to serve the Lord, choose you this day whom ye will serve, whether the gods which your father served that were on the other side of the flood, or the gods of the Amorites in whose land you dwell. In other words, hey, this land you in, the gods who couldn't defend their land with them, the gods who I just defeated to give you their land, he says you can serve them. I love this. This is Joshua saying this. Choose you who you're going to serve. You're going to serve the gods back there with terror? You're going to serve the gods in this land? You're going to serve the gods of Egypt? But listen to what he says here. And this is this famous verse. He says, but as for me and my house, we will what? Serve the Lord. I love this because this is a, like Father's Day is Sunday. Right? This is a great, great declaration from Joshua. This inspires me from Joshua, a 110-year-old man who says, hey, listen, make your choice. But as for me and my house, we're going to serve the Lord. We're going to serve Yahweh. We're going to serve the God who has shown himself to be strong on our behalf. We're going to serve the God of heaven. We're going to serve the God that who is real. We're going to serve the Lord. Let me just give you a few things about this declaration of Joshua. First and foremost, it's a personal declaration. As for me. See, guys, that's where it starts. That's where it starts. As for me. If he said nothing else, he could have said, as for me, I am going to serve the Lord. As for me. If the thing ain't personal, it ain't real. Nothing is real until it's personal. As for me. As for me. See, what this calls for on every one of our behalf, what this calls for is it calls for personal commitment. When God was saying to the children of Israel over in the book of Deuteronomy, when Moses was talking in chapter number 6, that passage that we call the Shema, hear, O Israel, for the Lord our God is one Lord, right? Love him with all your heart, your soul, your mind, your strength. He says you got to have this in your heart and teach it to your children. But you see where it starts? You got to have it in your own heart. Because you cannot teach what you don't know. You cannot lead where you won't go. So there's a call for every man in this place to have this personal kind of a declaration like Joshua. It was personal. Joshua was 110 years old. Joshua himself had seen what God had done. Joshua himself had experienced the power of God and the person of God, how real God was. Joshua himself, he knew God was real. He had seen God, hold a sun in place. He'd seen God devour nations. He'd seen God defend them. He'd seen God, Joshua himself, he'd seen it. He says, that's for me. So, guys, this is where it is this morning. Where is it in your heart? This is a personal decision. How is it with you today? How is it with me today? You see, he said, hey, you got to put away the other gods and serve the Lord. See, it's folly for us to think that we can. Jesus said this in Matthew chapter number 6, I think verse 24. You cannot serve God and money. You cannot serve two masters. And I think really many of us really believe that we can. Many of us really believe we can serve the Lord and serve money. We can serve the Lord and serve power. We can serve the Lord and serve lust. We can serve the Lord and have some other thing that controls us and some other thing that gets our time and our attention and capture our thoughts. We really believe that. That's why we can wave our flags and we can say in God we trust, all of these things here in our American Christianity, and yet it ain't real. I want to just say, if you're serving money, you're not serving the Lord. Now, that doesn't mean that God can't make a Christian rich. God can make a Christian rich. But if you are a person in here who says, I'm going to be rich, you know what that reflects? That reflects a heart that is serving money. Now, don't argue with me. That's 1 Timothy chapter number 6. The Bible says, hey, listen, they that will be rich, that is, will be rich, you're serving money. Now, if you serve the Lord and God chooses to make you rich, wouldn't it be great? Wouldn't that be great? Right? Hey, Lord, you can test me, tempt me with this. It would really, I really think I'd be a good rich person. You know what I'm talking about? I don't know. Lord, keep me poor. But listen to me, what I'm saying to you. Guys, it's so easy for us to somehow in our minds think that we're serving the Lord and we're really serving money. Or serving the Lord and we're really serving self, serving pleasure. It's personal. Are you serving the Lord? Do you love Jesus? And if that's the case, then it's what Jesus said. You seek first, principally, the kingdom of God and his righteousness, and all these other things, the necessities and the niceties of life will be added unto you. You're not seeking those things. You're seeking the Lord. You're serving the Lord. You want the Lord's will for your life. And then if he fills your wagon with some stuff, then blessed be his name. It's a personal declaration. As for me, hey, it was a parental declaration. As for me and my house. Now, I've lived long enough to know you can't make anybody do anything. I can't make my kids love God. You can't. This boy here doesn't love Jesus because Billy made him love Jesus. You can't do it. It won't happen. So when Joshua's saying this, now listen, I believe there is an authoritative voice in here where Joshua's saying this is how it's going to run in our house. And certainly a man has the authority and the ability and the responsibility to say those kinds of things. But the truth of the matter is, you can't make your kids serve the Lord. But what I do believe this embodies is the idea of influence. Leadership is influence. That's all it is, really. Everybody's a leader. You're leading somebody this way or that way, but leadership is influence. And leadership is not commandership. Leadership is influence. I mean, a real leader inspires people to say, I want to be like that guy. When there's something in you that causes people to say, I want to be like that. And listen, you can lead people the wrong way or the right way. And certainly as God's men who have made a decision, as for me, I'm going to serve the Lord, then that influence then is upon our children and upon our grandchildren. I can't make my boy serve the Lord. I can't make my girls serve the Lord. But here's what I can do. I can be a strong influencer in their life. I can lead. Right? I can be what God's called me to be. One great preacher said, listen, don't get in the idea that somehow you're gonna have goals for your children. My children are gonna serve the Lord. You're gonna run yourself crazy. You can't do that. You know what you can do? You set goals for yourself. Then you have hopes and desires and prayers for your children. It ain't my children going to live for God. No. I'm going to live for God. And I pray and I desire my children live for God. See, the goal is not for my kids to be godly. The goal is for me to be godly. Then the hope and the desire and the prayer is that my children will be as well. It's the kind of influence that Abraham had on his house and on his household. The Bible says, I know him. His sons and daughters will be commanded after God because I know what's in him. It's that kind of a influence. It's the influence that Job had. If you just read the passage, Job with his children, how careful Job was about his kids and how they lived. And Job himself was the real deal. It was a personal decision. It was a parental decision. Beyond that, it was a patriarchal decision. You know what a patriarch is? A patriarch is a family father. A patriarch is like the oldest in the clan. The patriarch, Brother Roland, you're a patriarch. You know, we were little fair-haired boys one time. Now, many of us are the oldest person in the family. Not just a dad, but a granddad. Not just a granddad, but a great-granddad. That's a patriarch. Right? And that thing comes down like this. Babies have babies, and those babies have babies. And now I'm not just a parent, I'm a patriarch. And so when Joshua makes this kind of declaration, certainly it's personal, certainly it's parental, it's patriarchal. You know, he's a great-granddad by this time, 110 years of age. And he's not just talking about just three boys and two girls. He's talking about the whole thing, that his name is over. The kind of influence. And guys, you know, let me ask you a question. Here's a question for me. This question, I heard a preacher ask this question some time ago, and it's challenging. What would I rather leave as a patriarch? Here I am. I'm just 60 years old. And in my group, I'm the patriarch. My nuclear family, I'm the patriarch. I'm dad, I'm granddad, Gampy, I'm that guy. You are that guy, so many of us in our families. So the question is, hey, if I've got to leave something, what do I want to leave? $1 million to ungodly kids who are going to fight and scratch each other's eyes out about it? Or a godly legacy? I mean, that's a question to ask. What am I going to leave them? Well, let me tell you about me. It won't be $1 million. I'll tell you right now. I got it scheduled where, man, I'll have just enough money to buy my last Big Mac and die. I was driving in this morning. I took out my app. I checked my balance. I'm right on schedule. I mean, this is a challenge to me. It's a challenge. As a person, as a parent, as a patriarch. Can I say this to you as quickly as I can? 7 minutes left. Not only was it those things. Not only was it personal. Not only was it parental. It's patriarchal. Can I say this? It was patriotic. How many patriots we got in here? Can I say this to you? The Bible says, I think it's Psalm 33, 12. Blessed is the nation whose God is the Lord. Hey, you want to be a good patriot? It ain't taking up arms. It might require that, I don't know. But let me just tell you this. A good patriot, you want to be a good patriot? Love the Lord our God. The most patriotic thing you can do is to be a good Christian. And the greatest activism is evangelism. It's not marching here, marching that, waving this or doing that. I'm going to tell you, the greatest patriotism, the greatest activism is evangelism. Sharing the gospel, because righteousness exalts a nation. And no sense in going to try to kick the doors down at the White House or make somebody do something in Atlanta. The greatest thing we can be as patriots, people who love America, is a good Christian who lives it. He said, hey, you want our nation to be strong? Hey, you want us to have success upon the land which the Lord our God has given to us? You want to be blessed? Obey the Lord. Personal, parental, patriarchal, patriotic. Can I tell you this? It was practical. This thing, Christianity is spiritual, but it's also practical. You know what he's basically saying? He's saying, hey, listen, if you don't want to serve God, if you think it's too much to serve God, this goes for everybody in here. If I think it's too much to serve God, then throw your back out serving your own vain gods. Run on. You think you're going to come up with something better than serving the Lord? It's very practical. If it's too much for you to obey God, the God who's blessed us, the God who's saved us, the God who's given us all that we have, if that's too much, band of brothers, that's too much, Savannah. Is that too much, America, to serve Jehovah God, Yahweh God? If it's too much, then go on and serve your other gods and see what that gets you. Hey, if it's too hard living a sober life, then go on and live the life of a drunkard. See what that brings you. If it's too hard living upright and with integrity, then go on and live in your falsehood and fallacy and hypocrisy. Go on, see what that gets you. It's practical. And it's powerful. Lastly, it's powerful. He says, hey, if you serve God, God will bless you. And he says, listen, to serve the Lord, if you're going to serve the Lord, let's be honest now. You got to put some things around. In fact, when he says, hey, you go on and serve whoever you want, but me and my family, we're going to serve the Lord. They said, hey, we're going to serve the Lord too. He says, you can't serve the Lord. Look down at verse number 19. Joshua said unto the people, you cannot serve the Lord. What does he mean, you cannot serve the Lord? You know what he's saying? You got all these idols right here in your hand talking about you going to serve the Lord. You're kidding yourself. You kidding yourself. If you're going to serve the Lord, you got to get rid of some junk. So look, we can come to band of brothers and talk about serving the Lord, band of brothers, we just another. Hey, you kidding yourself. You got some stuff you know you got to need to, you need to eject. You need to, by the grace of God, evict, get out. And yet we're going to serve the Lord. Joshua said, you can't do it with your idols in your closet. Y'all with me? So this is a man's message. This is a message for a man, certainly for fathers. It's Father's Day. Let me remind you all of something I'll say to you, I think every Father's Day. Here it is, Father's Day. It's Father's Day weekend. So send out a preemptive strike to your children. Don't sit around waiting for your ugly tie. Don't sit around waiting for that on Father's Day. Let me tell you what you can do. Please. Now this is practical because this is good. Some of us right now, you have relationships just like that with your sons and with your daughters. I would say to you, I don't care how old you are, as God is your helper, ask God for wisdom so that you might have influence in the lives of your children. I don't know what has happened. If I can help, pray with you, give you some ideas, but maybe there is a break in the family. Here you are, the patriarch of the family, maybe. And there's a strained relationship, maybe bad marriages and bad this. All kinds of stuff exists in a room like this. Hey, use your thumbs, use your voice, call them, tell them what a privilege it is to be their dad. Send that out to your kids first thing on Father's Day. Do it today. Hey, I'm coming up on Father's Day just reflecting about how good God has been to me to be able to be your dad. Don't sit around waiting for them to give you something. You give them something. That's called leadership. I do this little, this thing every year. I'm gonna see, can I do it right now? I want you to listen to it. A child was born just the other day. Came in the world in the usual way, but there were planes to catch and bills to pay. He learned to walk while I was away. For I knew it, he was talking. And as he grew, he said, I'm going to be like you, Dad. I'm going to be just like you. The cat's in the cradle and the silver spoon and the little boy blue and the man in the moon. Well, when you're coming home, Dad? I don't know when, but we'll get together then, son. Going to have a good time then. When my son turned 10 just the other day, he said, thanks for the ball, Dad. Come on, let's play. I said, I like the sun, but not today. I got a lot to do. He said, that's okay. Then he turned and his smile never dimmed. He said, I'm going to be like him. I'm going to be just like him. The cat's in the cradle and the silver spoon, little boy blue and the man in the moon. Well, when you're coming home, Dad, I don't know when. We're going to have a good time then. We're going to have a good time then. Well, he came from college just the other day, so much like a man, I just had to say, son, I'm proud of you. Can you sit for a while? He shook his head and said with a smile, what I really like, Dad, is to borrow the car keys. I'll see you later. Can I have them, please? And the cat's in the cradle and the silver spoon, the little boy blue and the man in the moon. Well, when you're coming home, son? Well, I don't know when, but we'll get together then, Dad. We're going to have a good time then. Well, I've long since retired. My son's moved away. I called him up just the other day, said, I'd like to see you if you don't mind. He said, I'd like to, Dad, if I could find the time. You see, my new job's a hassle and the kids have the flu, but it's been sure nice talking to you. It's been sure nice talking to you. And as I hung up the phone, it occurred to me, he'd grown up just like me. My son was just like me. And the cat's in the cradle and the silver spoon. Little boy blue and the man in the moon. Well, when you're coming home, son, I don't know when. But we'll get together then, Dad. We're going to have a good time then. I say this every year. I remind myself of it. You need to be reminded of it. We don't get just what we want. We really get what we are, right? Little zebras have stripes because big zebras have stripes. You don't beget what you want. You beget what you are. And it's easy for us to go after this, that, the other thing and forget about what we are. Not what you have. Men, so we admire each other by what we have. You go out here in this parking lot, and we're ooh and ah over. In fact, somebody got a Lexus over there. I was trying to not to ooh and ah over out there. You can have a F-150. You can have a boat. You can have this. And it's easy for people to ooh and ah over what you have and ooh and ah over what you've done and ooh and ah over where you've been. But what you have, what you've done, where you've been is not the issue. What you are is the issue. I'm closing. Let me see if I can say this. Now, this is I'm preaching to myself and letting y'all listen. Twas a sheep, not a lamb, that went astray in the parable Jesus told. Twas a full-grown sheep that wandered away from the 99 in the fold. And out in the mountains and out in the wild, twas a sheep that the good shepherd sought. And back to the fold, yes, back to the fold, it was a sheep that the good shepherd brought. So why should the sheep be so carefully fed and cared for still today? Because there's a danger that if they go wrong, they'll lead the lambs astray. For the lambs will follow the sheep, you know, wherever they go, wherever they stray. And if the sheep go wrong, it'll not be long till the lambs are as wrong as they. So still with the sheep we do earnestly plead for the sake of the lambs today. For if the lambs be lost, what a terrible cost we sheep will have to pay. What a terrible cost we sheep will have to pay. So God calls for us to be that first. Father, thank you so much for your goodness today. Thank you for our being back. Thank you for these men. Lord, you know how I need this, just like every man needs this. God, do that work in our hearts by your Spirit that we cannot possibly do ourselves. Help us to enjoy our families, enjoy the great privilege and responsibility of fatherhood as we think about it in these next days. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen. Amen.